Anyone saw my talk last year on the same stage? Okay, then special thanks to you. It's very brave to come when you know what's going to be happening. Yeah, as Fabian said, we are using CMN case management in my current project, and I was really excited about it because I have a long history with Camunda. I never worked in a case management project before. And 2 months before I joined the project, I got a call from Robert where Camunda told us, you're too late, yeah, bad luck. We are not further supporting it. And yeah, then we had an interesting session with Falco, discussing concepts, how we can migrate from this case management to a process, but still keep all this flexibility. And it was all on paper, and I'm more this practical guy, so I wanted to see if it can work. And I thought to push myself to do this, I just hand in this talk proposal. And Camunda said, no, we don't take you this year. And I said, okay, good luck, I get a free ticket, I don't have to do any work. And then they called me and said, a slot opened, now you have to do it. So I'm here. You probably saw me coding yesterday, the live demo I like to do just to keep the stress level up. Was finished later last night. Simon was there holding my hand until it was finished. Yeah, but obviously, start with intro. That's me. I don't want to brag about myself. I've been around for a while, did a lot of workflow and process management before Camunda. I'm in the lucky position that for the last years I solely did Camunda, so yeah. And what sometimes I'm asked, which role do you take? Because as a process developer, process consultant, you do everything, but I really prefer to think of myself as a tech guy and developer, and that brings me to this slide. I don't know if any of, of you knew, today is day 256 of the year, so it's 2^8 or 100 in hex. This is known as the World Programmers Day, and yeah, I wanted to just to put the slide in to say thank you to all the great guys I had the I could talk for the last 2 years, many today's the many interesting presentations. This open community, I think, this is really amazing with Camunda. It's not open source; it's open mind. You can share and discuss everything. So yeah, looking forward to next year already. Okay, as I told you, I use case management in my current client's project. It's EOS, it's a debt recovery company. So if you buy a washing machine and then don't pay it, and even though you are told that you might pay it soon, please, then you might get a letter from EOS taking this over and they do debt recovery. It's not the best image, but think of it like for today, for the success story, there's a very friendly, nice company in Berlin which does process engines and great products, and there's this evil big corporation that just refuses to pay, and then we come to the rescue. my PO, Carsten, had a talk on the main stage last year. Anyone grabbed it? Where he presented what we are doing in a whole. It took him 45 minutes, and so I have to skip it. There's a video link in the slides. Basically, what we do is we have this huge case in the back, which is basically a catalog of all activities we can do during a debt recovery process. So typically, we can send out a letter where we just remind you to pay. We can call you. We could go to court or do some payment agreements where you don't pay in full. And we have this three-step process that orchestrates what's happening. The first step is we have an analytic engine, so there's some machine learning involved that calculates, okay, for this young guy who never pays anything, we have different measures than for this nice old lady that for the first time in her life just forgot to do it. Then we have some legal restrictions and customer-specific restrictions, so we do constraint solving with DMN, And afterwards, we execute the process via BPMN. And since I want to do a live example, and this is too complex, let's consider a very simple case. We just, the first thing is, we have to send a letter now, EOS is taking over. Then we could call you, we could send you a letter or a mail. Then you pay, and then we say goodbye, fine, thanks. And this is really simple. It's a perfect example how to do it in BPMN. It's not meant to be executed. But then constraints come in. So obviously, we can only decide to call you if you have a valid phone number. Phone numbers change. We can only send you a letter if we know your address. We have, after we send out a letter, we have to give you some grace period so you can react. We must not do any other action. Then we must not try to call you more than 3 times per day. It's a law. And the customer might decide that he wants to keep you as a customer, so even though you didn't pay this one washing machine, maybe you will buy another one next year, and then you might decide to keep it friendly, so don't call him too often or don't call in on holidays. And this is all to be considered while we're executing this. I already had this. Yeah, and basically we have to do, we don't know how often we will do these steps. It might be once and then you pay, might be take 4 years. So this is, again, not to be meant to be executed, but this plain BPMN, like we did it in the beginning of Komodo, this is roughly how this process now would look like, right? We had the first step is still sending this letter, and then we enter this weird interruptible, somehow decide what to do. You can always quit this if it's paid, and you have timer, and this is just for this 2 steps, and as you saw, we have, I don't know, 40 in this case, 40 activities we managed, so this is something we did not decide to do. And if I would choose to implement this with case management or CMMN notation, it would look something like this. Yeah. So I have a mandatory task with the exclamation mark sending out the letter, then I reach a milestone, then I enter the stage. Where can I repeatedly, that's this, what is the dash? And the play button, these symbols on the left indicate sentries, so there are conditions. If the conditions are not met, then I cannot start it. And then some, at some point, an event debt paid occurs and I finish. So, and yeah, this looks cool. This is quite useful. And 5 years ago, this would have been a great presentation because now we solved all our flexibility problems we had with BPMN using CMMN just by Komodo. I think one of the, I didn't actually find another vendor really implementing it, which pushes your point somehow. And yeah, back then they had this great motor block where now we have the 3 OMG standards working together. It was really hard to get this one because I did a good job of not shouting out to the world that they're doing CMMN anymore. Now it's out. Yeah. And now we have to deal with it, which brings us to just some information. I think we didn't agree on the date of CMMN, maybe, so around 5 years, maybe we can agree on this. And back then, we did a lot of research and blogged about it. So what is what are good processes for BPMN, what are good processes for CMMN? And we came up, I think it's commonly used, that we decide between strongly structured, so I know it's A, B, C, and weakly structures. So it might be A and C, never B, B twice, whatever. And yeah, that actually is something that, to me, to just get it, I explained this with dealing with surprise, which refers to the title of this talk. Dealing with surprise does not mean that I wonder if the demo would work. It's I have to handle surprises. And as you can imagine, in our project, since the analytic engine decides what the next step is, it's always a surprise. We never know what the next action will be in our project. Okay, these are some indicators. You maybe have heard it in when you discuss and analyze processes with your clients. That you try to implement a process, and then you learn that some tasks have to be repeatable or executed anytime a user wants to. Or they say this is individual, we cannot put a strongly structured process to implement it. And very common in case management as well is that I have to see some case views, so I see everything that ever happened in this context, not only the steps of in the user task. In a typical process, you just get the information you need to do this one task, and for cases, typical to see everything that happened in the history. Okay, there are some problems with CMMN which led to the decision as well. First, the specification is way not as mature as Weedman, and it's way younger. After Camunda started implementing it, it was version 1.0, then it switched to version 1.1 and just flipped some execution patterns around. So it's they allow high level of flexibility. They really said, okay, I can do anything and decouple anything, but it might not be the level of flexibility we need. We still have to handle and automate it. We will see it later in the example that although this diagram looked nice, I have to do a lot in the back, even the modeler, to get this running. Second problem, lack of tool support. Our preferred vendor just called and said, we are not doing it anymore. And even before, as you said, you're doing this in an iterative way, a lot of elements were not supported. So if you remember this debt paid event that I put in my case example, this is not supported by the engine, not even before they decided to not continue. So some stuff that I can do in a BPMN process is just not supported by tools. And as Fabian said, it's chicken egg problem. So if there would have been demand, then maybe. And third, but maybe most important thing is that over the years, using BPMN files to discuss how processes work with customers and business really proved to be valuable. So we had a specification where we could use it for execution of process, but also to discuss what's going on. In the simple example that we saw before, that might be possible, but if you use larger scale case models, you, because of all this flexibility, and you just cannot discuss, okay, this is A, this is B, and maybe C, you just have this big plan of notation that is, compared to BPMN, uncommon and hard to read. So, this is one other reason why it never took off. But there's some stuff in CMMN that I really like and that's really useful to implement flexibility in processes. This is the task stage lifecycle. It basically says that when I start a task in a case, it becomes available, and then depending on if I want to start it manually or automatically, it either gets active or comes in this enabled, disabled cycle, which is extremely useful for the sentry evaluation, as I told you, so we can enable sending out a letter when we know we have a valid address, and disable it again when someone moves and we just don't know about it. And the other thing is, we already had this in the model, there's some extensions, some aspects I can add to a task. First one is making a task mandatory. So you can think of, you have no strict flow anymore, A, B, C. You've loosely coupled, you can choose, but you can still mark task A has to be done at least once until I can leave the process. Manual start is really useful. So it does not start when a process token hits the next step. It just waits there for me to execute. If it's enabled, then I can run it. Repetition rule. So I can decide to do the same task more than once without implementing a loop in a process. And as I mentioned, sentry, so I can put conditions on a task which influence if it's enabled or disabled and if I can execute it or not. So the idea now was to keep the good stuff and implement some CMMN light or highly opinionated, limited CMMN that allows us to keep this and this, but run it inside a process. So I think there's no real big surprise that flexibility in BPMN will be done via event-based sub-processes, something that the engine did not support back then, but I think it's in there since 2017, maybe. This is really useful because I can say, leave the outer process running, and if, in this case, some condition occurs, run this inner. And this is basically from the slides or the material we developed with Falco during this workshop. And but it lacks in the plain BPMN implementation. You have no life cycle on these event-based processes. You have unlimited repetition, so every time this condition changes or a signal arrives, this can be executed, and conditions are hard to implement. So in a naive approach, you could think that after this condition start event, you do some gateway and then just end the process, but that is not the semantic you really need, because then your history tells you that you have run this 100 times and only one of these times is actually something happened and the 99 others are just trying to run and fail. So yeah, this is something I try to come around in the demo, case management extension. Yeah, you might have heard I like to do everything I implement and explore in an extension. So this is already in our space on GitHub, might become some extension candidate later. I had some goals. I was my own product owner, so I had to limit the scope. Simon kept telling me that you know that you have 2 weeks left, and I said, okay. I wanted to build something that can be reused, so it opinionated my opinion, which is the useful part. I wanted to implement this minimal example process that I showed you before, so send out hello letter, phone call, or mail, and then finishing by debt payment. I will use event-based sub-processes, and I want, from this good stuff, I want to support task lifecycle. I just need the active task lifecycle, so if we remember, there was some completed and cancelled stuff, just focus on this available, active, enabled. And I wanted to be able to control the manual start of processes. And another goal was to do this not by putting just a piece of software besides Camunda that somehow handles the state and transitions. I wanted to build this inside the Camunda tooling, so using the Camunda API and the modeler features only. So this can really be reused without putting some external state store next to the main process. And really important, just so you heard it at least once, if I would call the Camunda runtime service directly and say, correlate this signal or change this condition, then it would directly hit via the API the process through the Camunda API, and I wouldn't have control over this state. So it's not only for this case management, it's in general, it's a good pattern that we came up with in our project to use some process instance wrapper pattern. So just now you heard it once, naming things is hard. Yeah? So it's the 3P for now. I share credits. If you come up with a good name, then we can blog about this. So basically, to start a process, I not call runtime service, create process instance with some business key in some way. I build a command where I say this command holds all the information I need to start a process, and then I hand it over and then reroute it to the API. And in return, I will get a Java POJO instance that wraps the Camunda process instance and allows me to do more business-oriented operations. So I do not say, please give me variable for this string key. I can just say, please give me number of calls, or I can say, please complete a user task or anything. So everything that I normally would do using the ID is now wrapped in a. Just important to know when you ask yourself now in the demo, why isn't this directly hitting the API? Because I have a layer in between. This is the trick I had to do to implement this. Okay, now for the fun part. You remember, share my screen. Okay, you may remember this one from the example 5 years ago. And who did ever implement such a case model here? Okay, then cool. Then you know that the just the modeling part is not enough. I mean, I see this play button here, which means I want to choose when I start this task. And I have this dash here saying I want to do it repeatedly, but just by using the graphical notation, this will not happen. I have to select this task and go to this rule panel, and there we have a rule for manual activation, and I have to set this to some expression which returns true, so only if this rule is true, then the actual manual. This is really annoying, and basically we always write true as the expression inside there. We have the same for do you really want to use the repetition, and something similar on the sentry where you have some if part conditions. So I have to write some connector here where I say my bean check. So this is, although this is CMN, MMN, this is something I have to do in the model to get it working, and that's where I hooked in and said, okay, let's build a BPMN process with event-based subprocess. I have this send hello letter, remind via telephone, and remind via email. And then I use something that I think has been in the model of forever, but I'd never had a real use case to do so. I have extension elements, so basically I can choose to add additional attributes to the XML of the model. And here I do the same that I did on the other side with the CMMN. So I just define some marker. I am a human task in this case. I could also be a process task. This is needed to pass the model and identify this as something that is relevant for my case management extension. I choose that I want to start this one manually. I have this sentry if part condition, so it's an expression evaluating true or false, telling me if this task should be active. And I have a repetition rule. Complete means this is wording is taken from the CMMN spec that I can only start this activity again when the first one finished. I can also choose manual start. That means whenever I like, I can just start a new instance of this. And for the hello letter, this is no repetition rule, so I can only execute it once. And for the for this demo, I choose to run it manually as well. Of course, normally this would be the first step happening automatically. Something on the roadmap to-do list. And yeah, you see, since I have this model plugin, a lot of listeners there. Our listeners on process start and every task execution where I get the delegate execution from the context, so I can decide to change the sentry states and everything. let's see how this works when I run it. Okay, up and running. This is something we should really fix for at least for development with the Spring Boot starter. I think admin is, in other words, I type most of the time. Okay, so we have no running processes, but we have this debt recovery process deployed. And since Daniel did a terminal, just command line interface, I thought I could do one better. So I have a graphical UI for controlling this service via REST. And the first thing we are going to do is just to start a new instance, not calling the Camunda API directly, but wrapping it in a command and sending it to this process bean. We should have gotten some, let's check this here. We get the process instance we started, and we also get some data for the sake of this demo. All the relevant business data I need for my debt recovery is just some info in the data block. And the interesting stuff now is hidden somewhere. Let's do it via the fallback. It's here. So for my process business key one, I want to get. So this is, I had this extension elements on the process, and when the process was started, the model was passed, the extensions were interpreted, and I got this list of CMMN relevant executions. So I have this remind via telephone. We see that it's a human task, it's manual start, and this sentry expression, and I also created some executions, which we now can. Can you see this? Probably not. Okay, so process is started, waiting for debt to be paid. It would be the best case. Now we want to send out the hello letter. And this is done via starting a task, business key one. We want to send out the hello letter. We try it out. Perfect. Now we have a user task that I can just complete here. Now this is done, and since I have no repetition defined for this first task, if I do this again, it does not trigger a new execution because there's no enabled state activity waiting for the start command. I would now like to, or the analytic decides, or I decide that I want to just send a mail reminder letter. And we also see that it's not executed. That's because we have defined here a sentry condition. So this expression has to evaluate to true so I can start it. I marked it here. Didn't mark it. I'll show you in the modeler process instance. This one. I have some process data. The hello letter is sent, which is cool, but I don't have a valid address. This is false, so I cannot. Send this out. So let's change this. I'm putting this to true. It's another great UI to interfere with processes. And if I now for process one remind via email started, I will execute this action. And just few seconds, no, they just passed, just the proof of concept. If I try it again, I don't have a second execution, because as you remember, the repetition rule for this one is set to complete. I have to complete this task before I can execute it again. Okay, slightly over, this is the demo. Now let's just finish this off by here. Damn. Do you see anything? No. Now you see it. Okay. Yeah, just for closing this, everything you saw is on GitHub. We have this virtual company called Holunder, which started this in April Fools, Holisticon and Camunda, and we do this for all this. Yeah, when things are not officially Camunda extensions and we just play around with them, you can check it out. And yeah, the interesting question now, was it useful? So I'd like to discuss it. I'm around for another 1 or 2 hours. If this would become an extension, I would need support in some areas I'm not really familiar with. So in the model, I would like to see the play button and all these case symbols on this task. And I would also like to see in the cockpit, not only the active instance, this blue one instance, I would also like to see that there are two enabled. And so all this state information should become a cockpit plugin. Yeah, that's basically all for me. Thanks a lot.